extraordinary decorated and colourful armour, uniquely developed in Japan, was primarily designed to absorb the impact not of the feared Japanese sword, but of arrows. Japanese armour, as Oriental specialist Ian Bottomley suggests, is deceptive. It is light and flexible and functional.
Japanese armour looks rather decorative, but in practice, it's designed to give freedom of movement.
Keith Ducklin, a trained Royal Armoury's fight interpreter, regularly demonstrates Japanese armour and fighting techniques in the Royal Armoury's museum. This is the best way to try and test Japanese armour.
My European armours weigh 85 pounds, this weighs about 50 pounds. So it's really heaven by comparison to anything that I tend to wear at any other time of the day. The most difficult part of it is actually the helm, because the helm, as you can see, is very clumsy and it has the elaborate crests on the top. So it's clumsier in some ways, but again, it wasn't made to do the same job as European armour, so there's a lot more freedom in that sense. It moves with you far more than a European armour does. I'm not sure I trust it to protect me in quite the same way, but it is a different philosophy.
Like all Asiatic armours, it is in fact made of lamella, of iron and rawhide, laced together with silk braid. And together this combination absorbs the energy of an impact or a cut before actually penetration can take place.
While mail was worn in Europe, lamella armour, small plates of metal bound together, were the main defence not only in Japan, but across the whole of Asia for over 1,000 years. Small pieces of overlapping metal or leather plates are laced together with fine leather thongs to give the horseman a flexible defence against the main Asian weapon of the time, the composite bow. Layers of silk were worn under the armour to add further protection.
This kind of defence has kind of internal springs, so that anything that hits it doesn't exactly bounce off, but the kinetic energy of the impact is absorbed by all these springy materials. Armour's always designed for a particular purpose. This type of armour is designed for wear on a horse against the threat of archery. And of course the principal weapon throughout Asia for most of that period was the composite bow.
The Mongolian horse archer was covered in a coat of flexible lamellar armour which extends to cover the back of the horse. As with all armour,
it's a matter of what's most useful on the day, at the time, against the weapons which are around on the battlefield.
This Asian lamellar armour was the main influence in the evolution of Japanese armour. Japanese culture is unique in the way it has revered and preserved arms and armour. There are deep and binding traditions, particularly those connected with the renowned samurai warrior and his distinctive armour.
When you are dressing in Japanese armour, it's normal, as in European armour, to start from the feet first and work your way up to the helmet. But in conditions of war or in emergency, there are methods of getting into the armour very quickly, one of the simplest being to hang it up by a rope and dive up from underneath it and emerging through the armour holes. It's probably effective as solid plate armour, but in a totally different kind of way. It resembles, in fact, some of the modern lamellar armours used in things like bulletproof vests and for armour on tanks.
Like his European counterpart, the samurai warrior placed great importance on what was worn under his armour. Soft materials were worn next to the skin to increase the armour's ability to absorb cuts and blows. If the samurai warrior was very wealthy, he would wear full, sumptuous court dress under his armour as a mark of his rank and social position. But not all samurai were wealthy. Many used whatever material was at hand, wearing several tightly wrapped layers of a cheap and practical material such as hemp under their armour.
During Japan's early history, armour was very much the prerogative of the rich, although their retainers wore a very simple kind of armour. But during the 16th century, during the prolonged and very vicious civil wars, all classes of fighting men wore armour, from the very rich to the very poorest peasants who were recruited as matchlock men.
By the late 16th century, Japanese warfare shared many similarities with Western battle practice. They used matchlock guns, their famous swords, and had cavalry and artillery, and wore mail and plate. During the long Age of War, which was a series of violent internal feuds, the country had been torn apart by bitter and violent warring factions. When the violence subsided, Japan enjoyed a period of peace and seclusion from the outside world for 250 years. But despite these peaceful times, owning impressive armor was still an essential status symbol.
During the later period of peace, which continued until the 1850s, 1860s, once again, armor became very decorative because it was simply a costume. And you displayed your wealth by the quality of your armor.
The Japanese samurai warrior, though exalted, was rarely rich enough to buy his own complete set of armor. So he collected it, piece by piece, over his lifetime. As each piece was purchased, it would be carefully decorated and lacquered. The samurai wanted to be noticed on the battlefield. The more extravagant the colors, the more individual the design, the more the samurai warrior stood out.
Japanese armor was originally devised for use by mounted horsemen, and such features as the large shoulder guards, which replaced shields, are one of its characteristic features.
The Japanese helmet is also sumptuously and exotically decorated. But like the armor, it is also designed for a practical protective purpose.
Although the helmet and mask look rather grotesque to us, one of the main functions of the mask was to simply act as an attachment point for the helmet cords, which, if you tied it under your chin, tended to loosen. But if you tie it onto the mask, it allows you to tie it very tightly to your face. The helmets on Japanese armour look peculiar to our eyes, but again, they were devised initially for use by mounted archers. And the turnbacks at the edges of the neck guard originally acted to protect the face from arrows coming from the opposition.
Japanese arms and armour are elaborate and unique. They defined the warrior's individuality. And it reflected the reverence the Japanese have always had for their arms and armor, and for the special role the warrior has had in their culture.